Morning, student. Let us move to chapter 4. We going to have the third and the fourth problem for our midterm examination on this chapter. And again, the midterm examination gonna be on Sunday, May 8th. And then time is going to be 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. is going to be in the evening. So please prepare for it. It's going to include 4 problems, okay? And the third and the fourth gonna be in this chapter. On this chapter, we come to the analysis of the beam and the frame. And the beam is going to be statically determined. The frame also. That means what? That means you can solve the beam and the frame by using the free body diagram and the equation of equilibriums. It's going to be repeat what we have from the edging static. So the first learning objective, I like you guys start by understand, okay, how we determine the internal force and the bending moment that occur on the beam and the frame. This is going to be the equation of equilibrium of usually it's going to be rigid bodies. Okay, that means the equilibrium equation going to be summation f sub x equal to 0, summation f sub y equal to 0, and summation of the moment going to be 0. We can determine what? We can determine the normal force, and we can determine the shear force, and we determine the internal bending moment. And then we must be able to draw the shear diagram to determine the Vmax and the moment diagram to determine the Mmax. This Mmax is very important because we're going to use this later to design the beam and the frame. And there are 2 methods to draw the shear diagram and bending diagram. One is going to find the equation. This one is very cumbersome, but it's important later when we're talking about some method to find the deflection. So we will concentrate on this one later. By the meantime, we will use the graphical method to draw the diagrams. And if you recall the graphical method, when you draw the shear diagram, we have 3 rules. First, you have dv by dx equal to minus w. Second, by writing this equation in a proper form, and then we do the integrate from a to b. And then this equation will be in the form of v sub b at point b, the shear at point b minus shear at point a equal to minus of, this is the integration of w. So it's going to be the AIE area of w actually is the area of the distributed force between a to b. And then we have the third rule. If you have the force upward, the change in shear force is going to be positive. If you have the force downward, the change in shear force is going to be negative. If you can recall this, you are in good position. If not, I will mention this later. Again, if you draw the bending moment diagram by the graphical method, first, we have the slope of this diagram equal to shear force. And the second, the same thing, if you write dm equal to v dx and you have integrate it from a to b, integrate it from a to b, you will get the equation in the form of m sub b, and then minus m sub a is the change of the moment between these two points, is equal to integrate the shear dx is going to be area of v diagram between a to b. And the third that you has for drawing the moment diagram, if you have this kind of moment, this moment is clockwise moment, the delta m gonna be positive. And then if you have the counterclockwise moment, the change of the moment at that point gonna be negative. Okay, this six rules are going to use to draw the shear diagram and the moment diagram later, and everything you know already. So please, if you don't review it yet, go back and do the review. And the problem that I like you work are gonna be three problem for the homework. First one, second one, and the third one. The third one is important. This one related to the foundation engineering. Okay, most of the time this one may be related to the steel design. This one may be related to the timber design, or the form like this. It can be related to the RC design. The result from what you saw, these problems gonna related to related subject. And you also have two problem for this one, for sure it's going to be related for the steel design, and this one may be related for the RC design. And all of this frame and beam is going to be statically determined. Okay, beam and frame. That means what we have is the unknown force and moment gonna be equal to the number of equation. So every time, please check, okay, about what the structure whether is going to be statically determined or statically indeterminate. The statically indeterminate structures will be studied on the last chapter of this subject. Oh, you still have two more. Okay, and then we come to what we have for example of statically determined. The pictures here show you the statically precast reinforced concrete beam. This beam is was tested in our laboratory. The setup is like this. If you consider the beam is supported by two rigid steel yellow frame. Okay, so we assume one is going to be in pin formation. Another one must be in the roller. And if you consider on the top, there is the beam. Okay, this beam is subjected to the force from the hydraulic ram. So on the top, you have the cross beam. And for the cross beam, there is the force P. This is act at the center of the cross beam. So there's gonna be the reaction occur on this cross beam, and this reaction will add to our precast reinforced concrete beam specimen. This kind of test we call 4-point loading test, because we have one here, two here, three, and four force act on this beam. And by doing this, you must be able to draw the shear diagram and bending moment diagram of this beam. I mean, maybe you may dock it later. Then, should we include the weight of the beam in this consideration? Okay, if you prefer, you may let me stop this one a little bit and move this one to a smaller picture. So I will have the area to show you guys about this. So based upon this, if you guys like to draw a full model, it depends on you like to include the weight of the beam or not. But typically, we may neglect the weight of the beam if the weight of the beam is smaller than P. And usually in our study, it is like that, okay? And then by doing this, you may go back, you will get the shear diagram. That is going to be kilonewton. If this one is 10 kilonewton, this one will be 5 kilonewton, and this one will be 5 kilonewton. Typically, if this is 3-meter beam, it's going to be 1 meter, 1 meter, and 1 meter like this. If you assume like this, this 5 kilonewton going to be the reaction of the beam. And I like you guys to do the draw of the shear diagram based on what we have. This is going to be plus 5 because the force upward. And then if you don't consider the cell weight of the beam, the uniform loss distribution between here going to be 0. So dV by dx is going to be 0. And then 5 kilonewton will cross this shear diagram. And then since there is no uniformly distributed load, so dV by dx over here is 0 until you reach this point. This one take the shear minus 5 and no W. So dV by dx equal to 0. And this one cross the diagram. This is going to be x meter. And then you made all this kilonewton meter bending moment. Again, you do the same thing. You put this one as the x meter. This is the pin. This is the roller. For sure, there is no external moment. So the moment at these 2 points going to be 0. Based upon this, what we have is dm by dx equal to plus 5. So the slope plus is going to be like this. This one slope 0. This one slope negative. Okay, so then what's the value of the moment here? The moment here minus this one, 0, is going to be 5 times 1. That is going to be 5, the m, 5 kilonewton meter. So this one is 5. And then, you know, the shear at this point is 0. Until here, also 0. So dm by dx is 0. The value of the moment in this region gonna be constant. And the moment here gonna be 5. Okay. And then if you try to find the moment here, you also can do so. It's gonna be 0. Let's say the moment at B minus 5, the moment here is going to be this area equal to minus 5 times 1. And then you can see M sub B is going to be 0 kilonewton meter. And then you got to say dm by dx is going to be equal to minus 5. This kind of shear and moment diagram you have studied in the engineering static. And if you don't know what Ajahn talking about, I like you guys again go back and review this thing. The second example let us come to the girder that one put in this portion. And also one supposed to be in this one. When we built the foundation of this bridge, this is going to be a big bridge. Okay, you may put the pie and then cast the foundation. And later you cast the pier of this portion. And then finally you cast this cross beam, the green core, this one cross beam. And you may call this one as the pier, and the red one is going to be the foundation, foundation, okay, of this one. During building this in the site, you cast this precast pieces concrete girder. It's pretty long, usually it can be 30 meter, and then you chip it by using this 18 wheeler called to the construction site, and then you use the crane and also the knowledge from engineering static to lift the girder into its position. This bridge is used by the Thailand Department of Highway and Transportation, actually supposed to call Department of Highway, and during this construction by using this precast pieces concrete girder, is going to be very, very quick construction, and it's also high quality since the beam can cast in the factory. Okay, and then later you may put the cross beam to link the beam together, and then you put the load pavement and the guardrail to the beach later again. The beam going to support by the rigid RC frame. We may consider the combination of cast of cross beam, the pier, and the foundation. If you model it, you may have this one as the cross beam, this one as the pier, okay, and then at the bottom you may say this one is going to be a kind of fixed support to resist the force. And then for the girder, for the precast pieces concrete girder, for sure when you put it into position, one you may say is going to be pin, and the other supposed to be what? Supposed to be the roller, and then you can estimate what the force the girder gonna carry. Is going to be the weight of the girder itself, is going to be the weight of the load pavement, the weight of the guardrail, the weight of the vehicle that's going to be moving on this one, and you have the way to estimate it based on the Department of Highway code. Okay, and later, you know, this one will produce the reaction. This one will produce the reaction, and this reaction will act to the cross beam, and depend on how many girder that you put into the position. Let's say if you put 5, this one supposed to be in symmetry. So how can you draw the shear diagram and the moment diagram of this frame we call it rigid RC frame and also for this beam. Okay, this is going to be your work as you are moving to the third year. And the third assumption or example, we are going to consider the statically determinate structural steel beam. I'm showing you the connection over here. You may join the beam, for example, if you consider this beam that join one side to the column and another side to the girder. You can see the connection over here is not really welded together. By doing that, you may assume this beam to be pinned at this point and then put the roller on this side. And then if the beam built by putting the slab, okay, cross the beam like this, the beam may subjected to uniformly distributed load. You use the knowledge from the chapter 2 and then you can estimate the load that will be X on this beam. So in this steel building, the beam and the joint, what I'm putting over here, this one supposed to be the joint. Okay, the joint connect the column over here and then connect again to the beam on this side. They're connected, okay, to a bigger girder. So the force will transfer from what we have, the floor over here, to the joint, to the beam, and then to the girder later. And most of the time we design this kind of beam, joists, and girder by the simple support. That means we use both in this type of connection and transfer the reaction, okay, by what we study in the chapter 2. And then the girder will transfer all the forces to the column, okay, and then it's depend on how do you model when you connect the structural members to the column. For example, if you connect like this, this form of girder, you may say this one didn't have a lot of welding. You may say the connection can be pinned. Okay. However, if the connection use a lot of bolt and welding, you may say that connection gonna be rigid connection. And then talking about the support is going to be some detail. I will talking about this later. I put a lot of effort into this because I like you guys to be able to transfer the 3D modeling of this simple structure into the two-dimensional size view. Okay, based upon this, is going to be three dimension into two dimension. And in reality, okay, let me assume the force that's applied to the roof over here as the uniformly distributed load. And as you see, the loading over here going to be in the form of W, let's say 1 kilonewton per square meter. It's going to distribute all over the roof metal sheet. And then you use the knowledge from chapter 2, transfer this force into the force that acts on this purlin. And this going to be in the unit of, I don't know, let's say if this one is half is 1 meter, this one is 1 meter, that is going to be 2 meter. So it's going to be 2 kilonewton per meter length of this purlin. And by the assumption, usually we assume this purlin we can assume this Purim in the form of uniformly distributed load. Okay, it's going to be not really fully connect. It's just have alignment in the same direction. By doing this later, you may model this Purim to resist this force of, let's say, 2 kilonewton per meter. And let's say the distance over here may be 1 point, let's see, 2 meter, let's say. It's going to be easier to say that. So you can determine the reaction over here. This reaction, that's due to the force. You may use the symmetry of this beam. Since this beam is 2 meter, it's going to divide into 1 meter here and 1 meter here. So this one gonna be 2 kilonewton, and this one gonna be 2 kilonewton. And if you consider the beam over here, okay, the beam over here will have the support here. If you assume it's pin, and you may assume over here is the roller. This a kind of overhanging beam. Okay, this one can be our hanging beam like this. We have the force, that's X. This one, 2 kilonewton from the purlin, 2 kilonewton, 2 kilonewton, 2 kilonewton. And due to the support over here, this one is in the form of overhanging beam. Anyway, if you put your attention onto the beam inside, this one is linked to this one, and also is linked to this support. Okay, by doing this, you may assume this yellow beam in the form of simple beam like this. So please go back and try to imagine how the load transfer in the structural system, in order you guys can be able to model the structure. Again, this one is going to be simple beam subjected to uniformly distributed load. This one is going to be what we call overhanging beam. Okay, you guys supposed to already be able to draw the shear diagram and moment diagram with this various type of beam and various type of loading, both point load and uniformly distributed load. Again, this is 2 dimension. I like you guys again use the same concept. Consider this one. This one, as we mentioned before, this one is going to be 1 kilonewton per square meter. The force that's acted upon the metal loop sheathing over here, and then the force will transfer to the girder. We put this one in this light blue. This one is going to be the light blue. Then by the 2 dimension, the purlin is going to be in the direction that extend out of the monitor. And then this one, oop, will be transferred to, I use the green, okay? I use the green. This is going to be the overhang. Oh, it's going to be overhanging beam in 2 direction. Sorry, oh, sorry for this one. It's not overhanging beam just in 1 direction. It's overhanging beam in 2 direction like this. Okay, and then the load gonna transfer later to the column. Okay. And then I still have more example. This one is for the laughter in Thai house. The typical view, maybe this one is going to be the three dimension, and this one is two dimension of the building supposed to be in this format. And then there is a lot of component. I like you guys to remember, so you guys can talk with engineers and technician when you work in the construction site. Anyway, let us consider the rafter that is in this position, and then you can see this rafter AB is going to be a kind of overhanging beam, and then is going to in the form of inclined beam. Okay, it's not in horizontal. The analysis of this rafter, since the roof have some angle in order when the rain come, so the water will flow easily. Okay, by inclined roof. So the rafter is going to be the inclined beam, and there are many steps. Again, that's you guys supposed to use the knowledge from chapter 2 for transferring the applied loads from the roof to the purlin. And then that means the light blue over here is going to be the area of the roof that transfer the load to the purlin. So the purlin gonna subjected to uniformly distributed load. Again, according to the building code, you got to estimate the dead load and the live load. You may assume more than what specified in the design code. Okay, building code, you cannot assume less than that. For simplicity, let me assume it to be 1 kilonewton per square meter. So based upon what we have, this one, this is going to be 1 meter, and this is going to be 1 meter. So per 1 meter of this roofing material will transfer the force to the purlin to be 1 kilonewton per meter. This one based on the assumption that you didn't consider the wind load and not consider the weight of the purlin, and then the purlin gonna be statically determinate. Okay, and then by doing this one, and you consider the purlin to be statically determinate, so each purlin will subjected to the load of that I said. This one going to be 1 meter. 1 meter times this one is going to be 1 kilonewton per meter. And then the reaction will act over here and act over here. This is 3 meter. So this one is 1.5, sorry, kilonewton. This one going to be 1.5 kilonewton, half of the load transfer to here. So this one going to subjected to, for example, 3 kilonewton. You can estimate it, okay? And I think due to the incline of this one, you may need to, for example, within this one is assumed to be 30 degree, the 3 kilonewton that act over here, okay, here must be project into this one and this one. So this one gonna be 3 and then cosine 30 degree, and this one will be 3 and then sine 30 degree. So you may rotate the rafter AB into the horizontal direction. However, the Lord in the vertical, not vertical. The word that's perpendicular. Let's say this one, perpendicular, gonna be 3 cosine 30, and the Lord that's in parallel direction. Sorry, this one is going to be this one in parallel direction, 3 sine 30 degree, and then you can model the force that's transfer from the purlin over here to the laughter, and the laughter assume to have the cell weight of 0.2 kilonewton per meter, so it's going to have W also, and W must be separate into uniformly distributed load along the length, and also this one along along is not length, okay, along is longitudinal direction. So when we talking about the laughter, which is the inclined beam, you got to be aware of setting up the direction of the loading. You must project one in the perpendicular and project one in parallel of this member. And the calculation gonna be more complicated than previous one. Now, your knowledge of engineering statics is extended to cover more complex structure. By this consideration, let me move again, okay, to our theory. Going back to what we have in the course of engineering statics, okay, you have studied the way to determine the internal force and bending moment on a given section of the beam and the frame. What we have for the internal force, you may recall that's going to be the normal force and the shear force. For the bending moment, we use the symbol of M. They are the resultant of the flexural stress. This one is the resultant of the flexural stress. And the resultant of transverse shear stress. Actually, if you prefer, you may put the axial stress that's going to produce the normal force as a given section of the structural member due to the external loading. This one was we estimated, okay, from knowledge of chapter 2. And then we use the method of section to cut the section and draw the free body diagram and use the equation of equilibrium. In short, the external applied forces, okay, or load is going to produce the stress. It can be transverse shear stress, it can be flexural stress, it can be axial stress, and then is actually to help us to compute or analyze the beam and frame on structure easier. We use the concept of internal force and bending moment. This picture show you this one is going to be the flexural stress, and this one is going to be shear stress distribution. Okay, I explain this one because this concept is important. You guys must realize that the internal forces and bending moment actually is just a concept to help us, okay, in the analysis of the structure. In reality, there are no resultant moment and forces in a given section. What happened in a given section are the statuses that act at that section. And based upon this, we know the internal forces and bending moment come from the stresses. So we set up the direction for the normal force, for the shear force, for the bending moment. We use the concept, okay, by measuring the horizontal distance in X direction from the left to the right. And then this one may be the axis for the shear force, maybe axis for the moment later. And based upon this, the tension gonna be positive. The positive moment will bend the member, or it will bend the, what I have over here, it's not very clear, bend like this, okay? This one for the positive bending moment. For the negative, it's gonna be something like this. So for the positive bending moment, if you decide the reinforces concrete, you're gonna put the reinforcement at the bottom. However, for the negative moment, you got to put more reinforcement on the top, okay? And they are important size convention. And finally, we talking about the size convention for the shear force. The size conventions are for normal force, moment and shear force are important, because if you won't follow it, your diagram going to be very weird or opposite to what it should be. And it's going to be hard to understand for the designer how to put the reinforcement into the structure, okay? And anyway, we have in the opposite direction, we have equal forces and moment due to the third law of Newton, okay? And then for the procedure of the analysis of the internal resultant, for example, if you guys have this three-dimensional model and you like to find the forces over here, for sure, this is going to be the pin to reaction. This is going to be the roller. When you draw the free body diagram, you got to put the unknown reaction into it. So draw the free body diagram of the beam. Again, let's say this one is 10 kilonewton. This one is 10 kilonewton. Let me put this one 4, 3, and this one 1 meter, 1 meter, and 1 meter. Okay. And then you must set what we have going to be the reference axis. This one gonna be the first step. And the second step, you draw the beam out of the support, okay, to make it free. And then the third step, put the known force. And the fourth step, you may put the reaction. And the fifth step, you supposed to put the distance and the angle. So that is going to be the step for the free body diagram. Now you have unknown. How many unknown? You have three. It's going to be A sub X, A sub Y, and B sub Y. How many equation do you have? You have three times N. There is only one free body diagram. So you got three equation. This structure gonna be statically determinate beam, okay? And then you may select which equation you like to use. Based upon this, usually you supposed to summation moment at A equal to zero. So you eliminate A sub X and A sub Y. Go back and you will determine the B sub Y. And you may use F sub X equal to zero. Okay, you got to put the direction of this one. For F sub X, you may put this one as the positive. And this one gonna be very simple. Your A sub X is gonna be this one, 10. And on the horizontal, it's gonna be 3 divided by 5. So that is gonna be 6 kilonewton. Okay. And for taking the moment over here, you may have B sub Y. Let me show you time 3 in this direction is going to be positive, and then it's going to be equal to this one, 10 times 1, and this one in the vertical direction plus is going to be 10 vertical 4 divided by 5, and the distance between here is going to be 2, okay? And this is going to be the total of 8 times 2, 16, and this is going to be 10. So we have B sub Y equal to, for this one, 26 divided by 3 kilonewton. Okay, if you prefer, you may put it in your calculator. 26 divided by 3. What do we have? 8.67. So you just put B sub Y equal to 8.67 kilonewton. And later, summation F sub Y, let me put it on other area. Actually, you supposed to work over here, but there is something coming later. Let me put it into summation F sub Y over here equal to zero. Upward is positive. So A sub Y plus B sub Y, 8.67, and then it's going to be equal to 10, and then this one is equal to 10 times 4 over 5, that is going to be 8, okay, so A sub Y is going to be 18 minus 8.67, it's not that hard, just do 18 minus 8.67, that is 9.33 kilonewton. So that is going to be 9.33 kilonewton. So the reaction are important. If you calculate wrong, the reaction incorrect, the next step will be incorrect. Next, you cut this one at a given point, okay, by cutting this, you get this one for 9.33 kilonewton. This is 10 kilonewton. You cut it at a half. So this one going to be 0.45 meter. This one going to be 1 meter. The A sub X over here, 6 kilonewton. So this is going to be 6 kilonewton. Now you get the free body diagram of the beam segment. You again use the equation of equilibrium, summation of X sub X equal to zero. You put this one, N sub C, in this direction, opposite to N sub C, 6 kilonewton. You get the normal form. This is going to be 6 kilonewton. You may put summation of F sub Y equal to zero. Downward, V sub C is positive. V sub C plus this one is 10, and then is equal to 9.33. Okay, so what you have, V sub C is going to be 9.33 minus 10. So it's going to be 0.67 kilonewton. So the direction of this is going to be in the opposite direction. If you answer 0.67 kilonewton, this is going to be upward. Okay. And finally, if you take the moment at C, summation of the moment at C equal to zero, and this M sub C is going to be counterclockwise equal to zero M sub C. And this one will be rotated in the same direction. So 0.5 going to be positive. And this one produced no moment. And this is going to be equal to 9.33. The distance between here to here is 1.5. So it's time 1.5. The 9.33 time 1.5 is going to be 13.995. And it's going to minus 5. So it's going to be 8.995. Or you may say M sub C 8.995 kilonewton meter. And in this direction, okay, and this one in the opposite direction, and this one is going to be in tension. And later, after you get this for mechanics of material that we have it before, you may compute sigma equal to my over I. That is due to the moment. And also, this N will produce sigma equal to N over A. And the shear force going to produce the shear stress VQ over IT. If you remember it, you can analyze for the stress. Also, you may design, use this one in the design of the section of the beam. So go back to the chapter 11 and 12. After you do the design, after you do the design, you get the section. You check for the shear stress, and then you check for the deflection later. Okay. So this what you already have from the first trimester and the second trimester. Again, the psi convention we measure in this direction. So we usually use the one that's on the left, like this one. We prefer to use moment this one and this one. This moment is positive moment is going to cause the compression on the top and tension on the bottom. Again, there is an example over here. I like you guys to grow toolkit, and I should mention about the problem for the shear diagram and moment diagram of the beam is in this subject is going to be a little bit more complicated and more practical than those we have from the engine static. Okay. Okay. Let you guys go to this example and study by yourself. You are going to find the internal forces that is going to be N and V and bending moment at this point M. Okay. I will go to it very quick. Since the BC is pin and this one also pin, there is no forces act on this one. So this one is going to be two force member. And by considering this, the 5 newton per meter going to move the beam downward. So the reaction that occur on the BC going to be in this direction. Okay. And basis on this, A is pin. You guys can use the concept of instatic to get the reaction A sub X and A sub Y at support A. At B, there is the axial force act in the BC direction. So you know this 45 degree angle. You take the moment at A, okay, and then you get the result. And then do the uniformly distributed load. You got to determine the area that is going to be 3 meter, 500 times 3 meters. That is going to be 1,500 newton that act at the centroid of this area. So if you measure this one, okay, you may start by thinking about this one is going to be F sub BC cosine 45 degree. This one is F sub BC and sine 45 degree. This one will produce the moment by time 2 and rotate counterclockwise. So this is positive. However, this one is going to time, this distance is going to be 1 meter and it's going to be in the opposite direction. Okay, this one is going to be 1,500 newton, and then you get F sub BC easily. And then you may see the A sub X is going to be equal to this one. Okay, the A sub X is going to be 1,060.7 and cosine 45 degree. Very simple. Okay, this one is going to be in this direction. For summation of F sub Y equal to zero, you get the A sub Y is upward. And then this one also upward. Okay, but this one is downward. You get the A sub Y to be 750. And then you can cut, okay, when you cut it, please, you may use this one, okay, as the free body diagram to determine the internal forces and moment, okay, that's going to be normal force N, shear force V, and bending moment M. Again, we follow the psi convention that we have, then we do the same thing. Okay, summation F sub X equal to zero, summation of F sub Y equal to zero, and then summation of the moment. You got the shear, the normal force, the moment by cut the section. And then if you said this one is going to be changed to the X, you may mean you didn't fix the point of D. Okay, so this one is okay, but the force that's X here, okay, gonna change. Okay, this one will change to 0.5, and then this is going to be X. This one going to be 0.5 and plus X. Okay, and then what you has this, this V sub D gonna change. Okay, the equation gonna change to what? It's going to be 750, and this one move. Okay, this one minus 500 times 0.5 plus X. What you have is when you change this one, okay, to be the X, what we have is the function for the shear gonna be in this form. Okay, you may reduce this one, is can be V sub D equal to 500 minus 500X. And if you put the X over here to be 0.5, okay, you put this one to 0.5, you will get this answer. This is the way that we can get the equation. And then we can use this one to plot it. Again, if you take the moment over here, the one over here will change to 0.5 plus x, and this one will be 0.5 plus x divided by 2. Okay, and then since you put this one and this one x, this one will change to x. Now you get the function m sub d as the function of x. This is v sub d as the function of x. You get m sub d as the function of x. You may use this value of x and you may draw the shear diagram and bending moment diagram. So the concept of the shear diagram and bending moment diagram, you just modify your problem, change the location, okay, to be the variable in order you get the function and plot the diagram. So it's not that hard, and you know about it already. This beam subjected to the triangle uniformly distributed load. Again, can you draw the shear diagram and moment diagram of this beam? This one supposed to form the ending static, okay? And what you have ending static, you must be able to solve in this subject. And again, you may find the function of the shear force and bending moment basis on the position x along the axis of the beam. Again, I should say this one going to be 0 meter, and then you measure this one in this direction, and this one is going to be x meter. You're going to draw from the left to the right, and by cutting and get the function of the shear, as I mentioned before, you can plot all the graph, okay, the diagram, and then you also plot the this one shear force diagram, bending moment diagram, and then you can find the Vmax. This is for the Vmax, and this one for the Mmax, and you use the Vmax Mmax as you have studied in the mechanics of material. Okay, so the procedure first, find the reaction. To find the reaction, you must draw the free body diagram of the beam and use the equation of equilibrium as I did mention before. And then you may select, for example, this one, you got to select the coordinate. This one, you got the force applied at V. So you may select two coordinates, okay, that related to this. This one x1 and this one x2. Ajahn, can I use only x? No, because 5 kilonewton cut the function of moment and cut the function of the shear into two portions. Okay, so the first one is going to be from 0 to 2 basis on this. But for the x2, it's going to start from 2 and then 2 over here, 2 meter, 2 over here, 2, 4 meter. So the length that you're going to consider also important. So x2, like I said, is going to be 4 to 4 meter. It's going to be in this region. For the x1, it's going to be from 0 to 2. You got to separate it. And then by using the free body diagrams here, you get the function of shear and moment based on x1. And if you use this one, you got the function of shear and moment based upon x2. Okay, this is x1, that is x2. And then you plot the graph. Okay, and this example, okay, I will let you guys have a chance to study by yourself. We are going to concentrate on this, and you guys already studied it in the engine static. We will we will compute the V as the function of X and the bending moment at the function of X in the chapter when we determine the deflection and also later. Okay, and during this midterm examination, we will concentrate on the drawing of shear diagram and bending moment diagram by using the graphical method, because the graphical method is more powerful than drawing it by using the equation that we just mentioned before. So I let you guys go through all of this example and try to study by yourself. Okay, based on that what we have in the past, that's the reaction, and then you may separate this beam into X1 and X2 because the beam has an or this continuous 2 kilonewton per meter force over here, and also the beam is this continuous due to the moment of 50 kilonewton meter. So this is X1 and this is X2. You follow what we have, you get the equation. Okay, and this equation is important. Let me show you. This is in the X1 is from A, the X is from A to B, or is going to be 0 to 5 meters from point A to point B. There are some important aspects that I should mention over here. If you observe from this equation, you may say the dV by dx, if you do the differential x1, you will have 2.5 minus 2x1. And then you get this one into minus 2. What is 2? 2 is going to be the uniformly distributed load. So in conclusion, you may say dV by dx is going to be minus of this uniformly distributed load. If you move further to consider this one later, based upon this, you will have dV by dx2. This one is going to be 0, unlike dV by dx1 is going to be minus of the uniformly distributed load. And also, if you do dm by dx1, so you have this one to be 2.5 x1 minus x1 square. So what you have is going to be 2.5 minus 2x1. And you can see that that is going to be the V sub x1. So in conclusion, we get dm by dx equal to V, the slope of what's so called slope of m diagram equal to the shear force at that point, or this one, the slope of shear force at a given point is equal to minus of uniformly distributed load at that point. Okay, and then if you do the second one, you get the same answer. By doing this, you may see this shear is a constant, so dV by dx2 is going to be 0. Okay, the same as what I did mention about it before over here, dV by dx2, no distributed load. And then if you do the same thing, dm by dx2, if you dip this one, is going to be what, minus 7.5, or is going to be v sub x to as I did mention before. So you can use these two equation and put it in the form of table with various x. The first one, x from 0 to 5. And the next one, we have x from 5 and then to 10. So you separate into two portion. And when you plot the graph, you must be using what's so called the scaling. You must use a proper scaling to plot the graph. That's going to come from the course of engineering graphic. So please do it very clear. And then again, we have some conclusion that I did mention before, the slope of the shear diagram, this one, minus 2, this one, minus 2, until this one, minus 2. Later, there is zero slope, okay? And the slope at the moment diagram, this one is going to be 2.5. And if you project this one, the slope is 0. If you come to this one, the slope here is going to be this one. Next, all the slope that's occur here going to be minus 7.5. So it's going to be a straight line down from B to C. And then there is some important thing that should mention over here. If over here A sub Y is up 2.5, this one produce the change delta V up, okay, or increase. The same thing over here. C sub Y is 7.5 upward. The del the force that upward going to produce the positive delta V or what's so called increase. Another thing we talking about this external moment, okay? If we have clockwise moment, the moment over here change to increase. So if in the opposite direction, you has the moment in this direction, this one, the delta M gonna be negative, okay? It's gonna be opposite in this direction. Now, you can make some conclusion based upon what we have in this various example. So go back, study the example over here. Draw the shear body diagram, draw the free body diagram and use the equation of equilibrium to determine the reaction and later cut the beam for a given point and set it as the function of x. And then you can determine the function of the shear and function of the moment. And you can get the same result, what so called the dv by dx equal to minus w and dm by dx equal to v. Okay. And then you can draw the diagram and try to use what you have over here and understand it and later practice it to develop the skill, okay? And also at the point of zero shear, that is going to be the point, the slope of the moment function equal to zero. So as we know, the point of zero slope may be here or maybe here. It can be the point of maximum and can be the point of minimum. So at the point when shear is zero, you can see the moment can be the maximum or sometimes it can be the minimum. Okay. And then there is the last example over here to show you about the difficulty when you must separate the beam into more section. If the beam is one or two portion, writing the equation and then using this equation, to draw the shear diagram and moment diagram is going to be not that hard. But if you have, for example, 3, 4, or 5 section, you're going to require a lot of trying or working hard to get all the function. If you have 3 coordinates, you're going to have V sub X 1, V sub X 2, and V sub X 3 to draw the shear diagram. And then you may have M sub X 1, M sub X 2, and M sub X 3 to draw the moment diagram. That require a lot of effort to do so. Okay, but it's not that hard, but it's going to take a lot of time for you guys to determine the equation. And later, when you get the equation, you're gonna take all of this function in the form of table, and then you put the data from the table and you draw the shear diagram and moment diagram. Again, the conclusion from what we have from this various 3 example, I will put it in summary, and this summary will be used later to draw the shear diagram and the moment diagram in the graphical method. Okay, so next section, let me move to what we supposed to do. First, the textbook talking about how the function comes from, and I think what we has discussed also can explain this derivation, and then we may say dv by dx equal to minus w, and the second one, dm by dx equal to v. By expanding these 2 equations, the change in the shear is going to be minus of the area, okay, of the W between 2 points. And again, the change in the moment, we said M sub B minus M sub A equal to the change in moment, or V sub B minus V sub A equal to the change in shear. And then from point A to point B, this one is the negative of the area of the load. And this one is going to be the positive, the area under the shear diagram between point A and point B. And then you guys to change from the mathematics function into words, so in order you guys can understand it. For the point load that move downward will make the change to be negative. Okay, for the moment, the clockwise moment will be produced the positive, what's so called M sub B minus M sub A is going to be M palm. Okay, if let's say this one supposed to be M palm, if M palm is clockwise. If M palm is counterclockwise, the delta M is gonna be negative, okay? And then for the conclusion, the dV by dx equal to minus W, and the slope of the shear diagram at a point equal to the negative of the load at that point. Okay. And the second one, the slope of the M diagram at this point is going to be the value of the shear force at that point. And when you extend this one, changing in the shear force between two points is going to be the minus of the area under the load between those two points, those two points. And again, the change in the moment between two points is going to be the area previously is negative. This is the positive area of the shear diagram between two points. Upward going to be positive V. Downward is going to be negative V. Okay, at the point where downward force acts, okay, the change in the shear diagram going to be decreased. Okay, and for the moment, clockwise moment is going to provide positive magnitude of the moment at that point. So I'd like you guys to go back and review this thing, and I should mention when you draw the shear diagram, you use 1, 3, and 5. When you draw the moment diagram, you use 2, 4, and 6. Okay, and then one more important thing is about the degree. Okay, when there is W equal to 0 here. Okay, the shear in this area gonna be a constant. Okay, it's gonna be a constant, and the moment is going to be a linear. Then, if this one change into a constant, the shear gonna be linear. The moment is gonna be a quadratic polynomial function. So the moment going to be one order more than the shear, and the shear is going to be one order more than the applied loading. Okay, so this is going to be another example. For triangular loading, the load is linear, the shear going to be quadratic, that's going to be x squared. The moment is going to be cubic, that is going to be x power 3. You get this kind of equation. These notes are important for checking what you have. So I have two more examples. Let me start by working on this example, and let me move to this one in order me to show you guys what we supposed to do on the examination, in order you guys will more understand on what we supposed to do. Okay, let's start on this beam. This beam has support A as the pin. Pin is going to be over here. Support E, E and F as the roller. So based upon what this information, we can see this is two reaction, 3 and 4 reactions. And then they also said there is internal hinge at C. So based upon this, you may analyze the stability and determinacy of the beam. You may say this beam is going to be stable by having the reaction not all in parallel and not cut at a given point. And then what we have from this one has 6 unknown. Why? Ajahn, you said that has 6 unknown, 2, 3, 4. And the hinge, you have 2 more. So for sure you have a sub y, a sub x, e sub y, f sub y, also c sub x and c sub y. And since this one connect by the hinge, so you have three n. You have the n is number of free body diagram. You have three times two, so you have six equation by considering this. Therefore, this is going to be static tree determinate beam in which you have the unknown equal to the number of equation. Okay, and then we're going to start basis up on this. We're gonna draw the free body diagram of the beam. Okay, and then you got to determine the reaction and put everything in the given area. Okay, let me show you guys in this drawing by putting this one. Let you may do set up a scale. Okay, first over here, this one, number one, two, we will find or determine the reactions by drawing free body diagram of what? This one, A, B, C, A, B, C, and C, D, E, F, and applying the equation of equilibrium. Okay, you got to show your understanding about this, and then by doing this, you may say, I will use the Hopper scale, let's say 5 meter per 1 centimeter. If you use that, that is going to be ABC, it's going to be 3 meter. And you have this one as A, and this one must be B, and this one must be C. And this one will be 1, 2, 3, and 4. Next one, you may dock it with a proper scale with 4. And then you have this one for C, and this one for D, and this one for E, and this one for F. Then let me put the load onto this one. This is 30 kilonewton per meter. And you have this one for 200 kilonewton, and this one for 100 kilonewton. Also, if you prefer, you may set up this one X and Y. We will use the reference axis later when we apply the equation of equilibrium. Now, next step, just put this A pin. We're going to have A sub Y, and also this one, we have A sub X here. Also for E, let me put this one as the E sub Y, and also this one, we supposed to have F sub Y. And in the connection at joint C, okay, under this one, if you take the moment at A, you can see 100 kilonewton will rotate clockwise. So for sure, we're gonna have this one for C sub Y to balance it. By the third law of Newton, the C sub Y on this section must be downward. And also this one must be C sub X. Okay, it's opposite to A sub X. And then third law of Newton. You got this one for the C sub A. Now, which free body diagram you going to use first? You, if you consider this portion, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. This one has 4 unknown. Okay, you consider this one. This one going to have, oh, 4 unknown also. How should we start? Okay, for example, this one, if you take moment here, you didn't get the answer. But for this one, if you take moment here, you may get the answer. So I will start by considering the free body diagram of A, B, C first. If you take the moment at A, I got C sub Y. But this one, if I take the moment for C or E or F, I didn't get the result. Okay. And then you got to put this one. This is going to be 10 meter. This is going to be 5 meter. And this is 5 meter, 5 meter, and 10 meter. And based upon this, you got to start by what? Let me summation of the moment. Some moment at A equal to 0. So I eliminate A sub X and A sub Y. I got C sub Y. That is going to be C sub Y over here. Taking moment here. That is going to be 15 C sub Y. And rotate counterclockwise. And it's going to be equal to 100. And 100 times what? 100 times 10. Okay, so we get the C sub Y equal to 1000 and then divided by 15. And you put it, it's going to be 66.67 kilo Newton. So this is 66.67 kilo Newton. And this one going to be upward. Okay. And then you may do the summation of F sub Y equal to 0. Now this one is upward and you have A sub Y and this C sub Y is 66.67 kilonewton plus 66.67 and then it's equal to this one 100. So your A sub Y is going to be 100 minus 66.67 is going to be 33.33 kilo Newton. Just put it over here. Now, what you have is A sub Y over here is equal to 33.33 kilo Newton and then upward. And if you move a little bit further by summation of X sub X equal to 0. This is positive. You got A sub X equal to C sub X. You didn't get the result of this reaction yet. So next, consider free body diagram of C, D, E, and F. Okay, now you have this C sub Y already. Okay, you have C sub X, E sub Y, and F sub Y as the unknown. By doing this, you may summation of X sub F equal to 0. This is positive. You can get C sub X equal to 0 kilonewton. So you have A sub X from this one equal to 0 also. Okay, they didn't require you guys to answer it, so didn't need to put it yet. Now, you may summation of the moment at point F equal to 0. Take moment here, E sub Y rotate in this direction. You may get E sub Y time this one time 10. Okay, this E sub Y time 10. And then it's going to be equal to, this is the 30 times 10. That is going to be 300 kilonewton. So this one going to be 5 meter times here. 300 times 5. And then you got this one. This one going to rotate in the opposite for this one again. Putting into opposite side of equal. It's going to be 200 times 15. And then the C sub Y is here. And it's going to rotate in the same way at this one. Plus 66.67. And then that is going to be 20 meter. And by following this, the E sub Y is going to be 5,833.4 divided by 10. So this is going to be 583.34 kilonewton and upward. Do we need to provide it? We don't need to. No, actually, it's supposed to be E over here, not the B, because the B is over here. So change this one a little bit. It's going to be 583.34 kilonewton, and it's upward. And then the last one, summation of F sub Y equal to 0. What we have this one, upward is positive. So F sub Y upward plus this one, 583.34. Oh, actually, I should draw the free body diagram for reaction here. It's okay. And then of this in opposite, so equal to this one, 300 plus 200. And then this one also plus 66.67. So our F sub Y going to be this one, 566.67 minus 583.34. So this one is going to be minus of 16.67 kilonewton. Or you may say F sub Y is going to be 16.67 kilonewton. The direction is going to be downward. So this one is going to be downward. Now, at what we have over here, this one reaction is going to be 16.67 kilonewton, and it's going to be downward, 16.67 kilonewton. And this one we have 583.37 kilonewton. And this one, what we have, the A sub Y is going to be 33.33 kilonewton. And we don't have the A sub X. It's going to be 0 kilonewton. Now, let me move over here. We got to draw the shear diagram again. To draw the shear diagram, dV by dx equal to minus W. And second, we have V sub B minus V sub A equal to minus integrate W dx. And third, if we have the force upward, delta V is positive. If we force downward, delta V is negative. And based upon that, we're going to set this one going to be X meter. And this one, we have about 30 millimeter. That is going to be shear and positive shear. By doing this, the maximum reaction is about this. That means we may need three up and three down here. So about six. So consider the scale. Let me use the scale 100 kilonewton per 1 centimeter. And then this is zero. I suppose to project this one down and project this one down also. And this is 10 and this is 15. This is 20, 25. And then up to here, it's going to be 30. And then by using this scale, okay, the force that's upward is going to be 3.3, let's say, put it 3.3 millimeter. So upward 33.33. No need to put the unit. Unit is here. And then following this, there is no W. So what I have here, the dV by dx equal to zero. And now at point here, the downward, take this one for 100, that's for 10 millimeter. So this one minus 100 plus 33.33 is going to be minus 66.67. And then all of this has no W. So the slope over here, dV by dx equal to zero. Now, the 200 kilonewton, take this one down. You got to take it for 2 centimeter. So over here gonna be minus 200. Minus 66.67 is going to be minus 266.67. And then if you consider here, there is no W. So over here, you get dV by dx equal to zero. Okay, you got to put the value and the slope. Show me how you compute it. Over here, you get the reaction upward. Okay, it's going to be this one for 583.44. So that is about 58.3 millimeter. So this one supposed to 58.3. It's going to take this one up over here. So plus 583.44 and then minus 266.67. You get this one to be 316.44. And now the W is going to be 30. Over here, you got to get the negative slope. Okay, dV by dx equal to minus 30. And this is going to be minus 30 all the way here to F. V from this one, V sub F over here, minus this one, V sub E, 316.44. And then it's going to be the negative of this area. It's going to be this one, negative of 30 times 10. So the V sub F is going to be minus 300 and then plus 316.44. So this one V sub F is going to be 16.44 kilonewton. So it's going to be positive over here. No, it's going to be 0.44, right? 66. Sorry, not 44. 66. This one, 66. 16.66. Now, you're going to draw the line that link between these two points. And then the slope over here also minus 30. And then the last one, you have this one, 16.67. This one from this one downward, take this one down. And this one is zero. That is going to be the shear diagram. And then you get Vmax of what? Equal to which one is larger? Plus 316.66 kilonewton. That is the important value. Okay. And now we move to the next one. After we find the reaction sector, we draw the shear diagram and actually movement diagram. Okay, now next for the movement diagram, I should say this is X meter. Again, this is going to be the moment in kilonewton meter. And again, what we have is going to be 0, 10, 15, 20, 25, and 30. And I also should mention about this one. This is the hinge. And you know, the point for the hinge, the moment over here must be 0. So put this one in 0. Also, this is the pin. Okay. No external moment. The moment here gonna be 0. This one is the roller and no external moment. So this one gonna be 0. And now you gonna review what you have. The first one, dm by dx equal to v. Second, you have m sub b similar to this, minus m sub a equal to integrate of shear diagram dx. And the third one, the clockwise moment produce delta m positive. And then the counterclockwise moment produce delta m negative. So draw the shear diagram. You take a look at this problem. Draw the moment diagram. You're going to consider the shear diagram. Now let me start by moving from left to the right, and there is zero moment here. And then we start by this one. The shear here is 33.33. Now we start by dm by dx equal to positive 33.33. Okay. And then this is 33.33. The slope gonna be like this. And what we have over here is going to be this point of B. So M sub B here minus 0 here is going to be, this is going to be, this one is going to be the area here. It's going to be 33.33 and time the distance here of 10. So M sub B is going to be 333.3 kilonewton meter. So what's the scale supposed to be? Again, let me put 300 kilonewton meter per 10 millimeter. So if I put this one, what I get is going to be about 1.1. So this is going to be 333.3. And then we have the linear line, and we connect the slope between these 2 points. And now what we have, this is the pin and this is zero moment. You may know for sure this one gonna be downward, but anyway, you got to specify dm by dx equal to minus 66.67. And then you may say this one will minus the same way. Yes, you just put them together. You get this one as 66.67. What is going to be the moment here? Is this is the point D, M sub D, minus, you may minus this point, zero, is going to equal to the area here, minus 66.67. And this one is going to be 5 meter. Your M sub D is going to be minus 333.3 kilonewton meter for sure. Okay, over here. And you may draw the line that link these 2 points. Now, the shear just change to this value, the dm by dx over here is going to be minus 266.67. And what's going to be the moment over here is going to be m sub e minus m sub e minus here, minus of minus 333.3. And then it's going to be the area here, minus 266.67 times this area times 5. So M sub E, it's going to be this one, minus 1333.3. And this one plus and move here is going to be minus 333.3. So M sub E going to be 1,666.6 kilonewton. For the scale of 300, this is going to be 5 centimeter to 1,500. So it's about this. So this is going to be the shear diagram, and the value over here is going to be this one. Okay. Now you draw the last portion. This is 316.66. So the slope dm by dx equal to phi. Okay, this is going to be 316.66. And then what we have over here, okay, is going to be 16.6. Okay, over here, dm by dx is going to be positive 16.66. It's not zero. So it's supposed to be the curve something like this. And then you get the M max equal to minus 1,066.6 kilonewton meter. For sure, this is zero because this is the roller. Okay. And The last portion that you may do is to put the reinforcement into the beam. If this beam is going to be the RC beam, you're going to put this one as the connection. Okay, let me put the beam like this. Anyway, by putting the RC beam, if this is the RC beam, most of the time, we're gonna have the concrete on the top and the bottom. Seeing this one hinge, okay, is supposed to has a simple basic reinforcement. It's not hook to hook it to make the link the bond between the steel hooking, make the bond between the steel and the concrete better. And then you can see this portion is in negative. So for sure, for the large value of the this one, you got to put more reinforcement. This is negative. And this is positive. So you may put more reinforcement on this large area. Okay. This for taking for the moment. But anyway, you supposed to understand a little bit more. You also, it's not required much, going to put the steel reinforcement. In this area, the shear is large. You may put a lot more steel in this portion. Okay, that means the distance between the stirrup may be very close to each other. Then the shear value get things smaller. Later, you may put the spacing getting larger for this one, just for the symbol. Okay. And the shear here are on this portion are small. Okay. The shear reinforcement may be a little bit have the spacing more than this one. So this is going to be the steel reinforcement. I should say it's enough. Okay, that's all for today. I cannot finish both examples, and next time I will come, I will try to work on another example that we have. I'd like you guys to go back and prepare yourself for this example. Next time we will work on this, and it's going to be quick because we don't have much time to finish this. So for today, thank you very much. We may run out of time. Do you guys have any question on this?